of Hompa Honganji, Hilo Betsuin. Rinpon Takahashi was born in Nagato City, Yamaguchi, Japan. He was raised at Joshoji Temple, a Jodo Shinshu Honganji Ha, owned by his family. He graduated from Ryukoku University with a BA in Buddhist Studies in 2005 and an MA in Buddhist Studies in 2007. Upon his arrival in Hawaii in 2007 and completing his orientation at Hompa Honganji Mission of Hawaii headquarters, he became an associate minister at Hompa Honganji Hilo Betsuin in 2008. He then moved on to become a resident minister at Kapa'a Honganji Mission in 2009 until he was assigned to become a resident minister at Lihue Honganji Mission in 2014, both on the island of Kauai. In 2018, he became the executive assistant to Bishop Eric Matsumoto at Hompa Honganji Mission of Hawaii headquarters in Honolulu. On July 1, 2021, Rinpon Takahashi moved to Hilo with his wife Noriko and is now the Rinpon of Hompa Honganji Hilo Betsuin. Those of us who remember Rinpon Takahashi when he was first assigned to Hompa Honganji Hilo Betsuin in 2008 are pleased that he has come, quote, full circle, unquote, and returned to Hilo as our Rinpon. Today, Rinpon Takahashi's topic is Learning from the Shoshinge. Rinpon Takahashi will share his presentation for about 60 minutes, followed by a live Q&A portion. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for attending the Hawaii District Ministers Association online seminar. I am Kazunori Takahashi from Hompa Honganji Hilo Betsuin. I am pleased to see all of you here today. The title of my lecture is Learning from the Shoshinge. And here is the outline of today's lecture. We will have 90 minutes and I'm planning to have a question and answer session at the end. So I cannot lecture on the whole Shoshinge, but I will try to cover the basics of the Shoshinge and read its beginning part as time permits. Okay. First, I would like to talk about the purpose of this lecture. I think those of you who are here today come from a variety of backgrounds. Some of you are familiar with Shoshinge, some of you are not. Some of you may be studying Buddhism, seeking the path or listening to Buddhism during difficult times or challenges. This session will focus on learning what the Shoshinge is and reading its beginning part and aims to familiarize all of you with the Shoshinge and teaching of the Jodo Shin Buddhism. I'm sure that some of you, especially the ministers, are already familiar with the Shoshinge. However, it is significant to read it over and over again. I think you can agree with this. In some book, the late Reverend Sokusui Murakami, a famous scholar of Shin Buddhism, said about the Shoshinge as follows. Shoshinge is generally considered as the introductory text for beginners in Shin Buddhism. However, Shinran Shonin wrote the essence of the Shin Buddhist doctrine in the Shoshinge. There are only 7 words in one phrase, 16 lines and 120 phrases and 840 words. However, it is a culmination of the tradition and originality that the Shinran Shonin entirely devoted himself to. Therefore, it is no exaggeration to say that if you study the Shoshinge, you have learned entire doctrine of Shin Buddhism, end quote. But this is the word of the Reverend Sokusui Murakami. Then I translated it into English, and I will show. So but this is the Shoshinge. Shoshinge will start from Kimyo Muryo Junyo Rai, Namo Fukashigi Ko. Then the Kimyo Muryo Junyo Rai has 7 words, and the total the 60 lines, 120 phrases, 840 words. And this contains the essence of Shinran Shonin's teaching. As you know, it was mentioned that Shonshige contains the essence of Shinran Shonin's teaching. So I selected this topic. I thought this is a good topic for this, you know, monthly seminar. Then I hope through this session, all of you will become interested in this text more or remember its importance. If you are studying Buddhism, or if you are in a difficult situation, or seeking guidance, any part of the Shoshinge can be a gateway to learn about the teachings of Shinran Shonin. I was born in the Jodo Shinshu Temple family in Japan, as Mrs. Fujimoto introduced, and have been serving the Honpa Honganji Mission of Hawaii as a minister. But therefore, fortunately, I have had many opportunities to chant the Shoshinge from my childhood and learn its contents. However, whenever I read it, there is still something new to discover. Shinran Shonin called other named followers Ondo Bo, Ondo Ryo, which means fellow travelers and fellow seekers. And he tried to walk the path of Nembutsu together with them. Therefore, are we speaking about the Shoshinge as a speaker today, but I would rather learn about the teachings of Jodo Shinshu together with you from the Shoshinge. And I'm sure that Shinran Shonin will encourage all of us to do so. Next, I will talk about how to learn Buddhism. Today, before I get into the content of the Shoshinge, I would like to talk about how to learn about Buddhism. This is because I have been attending Hawaii District online seminars since this past July and many other online seminars. And I have heard some common questions and comments during the Q&A sessions. For example, I always hear about the teachings of Buddhism, but when some people asked me what the Buddhism is, it is difficult to explain. Have you ever had this kind of thought? Well, I don't know how the teachings of Buddhism are connected to my daily life. I don't understand why Jodo Shinshu is important among the many Buddhist schools. So before talking about the Shoshinge, I want to spend some time talking about learning and listening to Buddhism. By the way, I'll change the subject, but do you sometimes eat Hawaiian food? There are many traditional dishes such as lau lau, poi, romi romi salmon, karua pig, and so on. However, when I first saw these dishes, I didn't know how to eat them, especially like lau lau, poi, you know. However, someone who has lived in Hawaii for a long time kindly taught me how to eat them deliciously. For example, in the case of lau lau, we must first remove the tea leaves and then eat the meat inside with the taro leaves. If this is not correct, let me know later. Anyway, and in the case of poi, I learned that it is good to eat with romi romi salmon. Then after I learned how to eat them, I enjoy them whenever I had a chance to eat. Just as there is a proper way to eat Hawaiian food, there is a proper way to listen to Buddhist teachings. And if you do not have that in mind, it may be a little hard to understand what is written in the Shoshinge, as well as the teaching of Buddhism. Let me share with you a few hints on how to listen to the teachings. And by the way, in the first place, what is Buddhism? What is Buddhism? And probably there are many ways to answer this question, and I'm sure you may have your own answers, but there is an academic definition of Buddhism. And the first is that Buddhism is the teachings of Shakyamuni Buddha, the Buddha's teachings. The Shakyamuni Buddha was born in present Nepal about 2,500 years ago. And after he attained enlightenment, he shared the Buddha Dharma in India. Now, amazingly, his guidance has been transmitted until today. Therefore, one of the definitions of Buddhism is Shakyamuni Buddha's teaching. The second is that the Buddhism is the teaching of truth. There are various universal laws in this world. For example, the sun rises in the east and sets in the west, which actually looks like that due to the rotation of the earth. But this rising in the east and the setting in the west is the same everywhere in the world, except for the polar regions. Also, things fall down due to gravity. This is also the universal law. Water flows from the top of the bottom. As you know, there are physical principles that apply to all things. And this truth is the same in India, Japan, and the United States, and all over the world. The existence of gravity was revealed by Newton, a 17th century scientist from England. Some people might think, oh, we are living in the 21st century in the United States, so it doesn't make sense to listen to what a 17th century scientist said. If you hear this kind of comment, what do you think? Yeah. And Newton discovered the universal truth on this earth. So whether we accept them or not, the gravity exists in the world. Buddhism also teaches the universal laws of this world, which is why it is defined as the teaching of truth. For example, you can understand that Buddha Dharma is a universal truth. For example, there are the teachings like birth, aging, sickness, and death are inevitable suffering. Or, there is an impermanence, the teaching of impermanence. Everything is changing. Although, it's sometimes difficult for us to accept it if we are faced with a difficult situation. So the second definition of Buddhism is the teachings of truth. It is the teachings of Dharma. And the third, Buddhism is the teaching of attaining Buddhahood, or the teaching of becoming a Buddha. So who will become a Buddha? It is the teaching for each one of us to become a Buddha. I'm sure that many of you are familiar with the Shakyamuni Buddha, who appeared in this world and attained enlightenment and became the Buddha. The purpose of Buddhism is to become a Buddha like Shakyamuni Buddha and turn our blind passions into enlightenment. Some people may think that, I'm not interested in becoming a Buddha, or is it important to become a Buddha? But therefore, I often say that Buddhism is teaching, Buddhism is a teaching to turn our suffering into peace of mind. In Japanese, 心の苦しみを安らぎに変える。Turn our suffering into the peace of mind. As I mentioned earlier, we all experience various kinds of suffering in our lives. I hope all of you are doing well, but sometimes we wonder why I'm the only one suffering like this. And sometimes we wonder how unreasonable it is. And in today's world, many people are experiencing anxiety and suffering due to the COVID-19 pandemic. I'm sure that many people encountered unacceptable situations. However, the Buddhism teaches not only universal suffering, but also how to live such human lives or how to solve such problems. So how can I become a Buddha, turning this suffering into peace of mind? So in Buddhism, there is a process called Kyo-yo-sho in Japanese. In the case of Jodo Shin Buddhism, this is Kyo-yo-shin-sho. Kyo-yo-sho means teaching, practice or action, and enlightenment. It is a process of attaining from suffering to perfect peace by receiving the Buddha's teachings, doing necessary actions, and attaining enlightenment. So, if you are sick, you may go to the doctor's office to get medical advice or take medicines. And when you feel better, you feel relieved. In the same way, in Buddhism, to solve the suffering that we encounter in our life, there is a process of listening to the teachings first, going through the process described in the teachings, and reaching enlightenment or peace of mind. Yeah. Let's talk some more about how to learn Buddhism. I often hear that it is not easy to understand Buddha's teachings and to keep remembering them. Then I believe that one of the reasons for this is that we hear about the world of enlightenment while we are in the world of human beings. I mentioned earlier that the purpose of Buddhism is to reach the world of enlightenment from the world of suffering. The Buddha is the one who has attained enlightenment from this world. The Buddha is often called the enlightened one. But therefore, the teachings of Buddha are based on the world of enlightenment. But this is called the overworldly laws. Okay? The world of enlightenment is sometimes called the Higan. The other Showa, you are familiar with the Higan because we observe Higan services. And this world is world of truth, the world of peace. However, we try to understand these teachings based on worldly laws, such as our mind, knowledge, experience, education, culture, and worldly values. Probably because of this, we may have a hard time understanding Buddhism. But therefore, it is essentially to put this worldly law aside and listen to the teachings. You know, at the temples, we always say, I go to the Buddha for guidance. I go to the Dharma for guidance. I go to the Sangha for guidance. We don't say, I go to my knowledge for guidance. I go to my experience for guidance. We don't say, we always say, I go to the Buddha, Dharma, Sangha for guidance. So it's important to listen. It's important to set aside our limited perception and listen to the Buddha's teachings. However, you know, this does not mean that we should ignore this world. We are living in a society in this world. We are a part of this society. And we have to make sure that we should not cause trouble to others or disturb the society. Then the Ren Yoshoni, who is the eighth head minister of Honganji, said this about, you know, living with Buddhism. Then I want to introduce it with you. Okay. There is a saying, Buddha Dharma, the host, secularity, the guest. Seeing things from the dharmic point of view, worldly affairs should be taken care of as they arise. Ren Yoshoni emphasized that the center of our daily lives should always be the Buddha Dharma. It's not that, you know, center of our lives, you know, our limited perceptions and listen to the Buddhism as needed. That's not a proper way of listening to the Dharma. The center of our lives should always be the Buddha Dharma. Okay. Then I want to talk about one more thing about learning Buddhism. There is a saying that the summer cicada has no knowledge of spring or autumn. How could that insect know that it is summertime? This phrase originates from Chan Tzu, a philosopher in ancient China, and was used in some Buddhist scriptures, including Shinran Shonin's writing. By the way, do you know cicadas? In my understanding, cicadas are not in Hawaii. If you have ever been to Japan in the summer, you may have heard their sound. They spend most of the time, most of their lives underground and live only a few weeks in summer after coming out of the ground. The saying means that cicadas cannot realize that they live in summer because, you know, they don't have knowledge of other seasons. I often receive some questions as follows. Sensei, it's hard to understand about Amida Buddha, Pure Land, because we cannot see them. Have you ever had this kind of questions? In such a case, a phrase about the summer cicada would help us in understanding the teachings. You know, even if cicadas hear about spring and autumn, they probably cannot understand because other seasons are beyond their perceptions. However, you know, all of us know there are, you know, various seasons. Likewise, even if we hear about some of Buddha's teachings, it would be hard to understand because we hear about the world of enlightenment, which is beyond our perceptions. It's as if the cicadas attempt to learn other seasons. Like this, you know, we are living in the world of human beings, but you know, according to the Buddha's teachings, there are, you know, various realms or worlds, including the world of enlightenment or the pure land. So Shakyamuni Buddha became aware of the world of enlightenment and taught us about it. Therefore, it is essential for us to rely on not our limited perceptions, but their guidance to learn the teachings. Accordingly, the new vision or Buddha's vision will be provided for our lives and bring peace of mind. Okay. So I want to talk about another hint for listening to the Buddha Dharma. Shinran Shonin refers to the method and model for teaching and for listening in his writing. This is a quotation from the Anrakushu, or the passages on the land of happiness, written by Master Taocho in China. He explained the principles of those who deliver the Dharma and those who listen to Buddhism. I want to introduce it here. The persons who teaches the Dharma should think of themselves as king among physicians and of his work as the elimination of pain. They should think of the Dharma that they teach as sweet nectar or milk of the finest taste. The persons who listen to the Dharma should think that excellent understanding thereby increases and grows, and that their sickness is being cured. Such a teacher and listener together can make the Buddha Dharma flourish. They dwell always in the presence of the Buddhas. End of quote. Earlier, you know, I mentioned the process of becoming a Buddha is like the process of curing a disease. So actually this is mentioned in this passage. Then just now, I talked about what Buddhism is and how to learn and listen to its teachings. I hope you will keep this in your mind. Then also, through learning how to listen to and learn Buddhism, we can consider the Shoshinge as the precious gift from Shinran Shonin. I hope this will be helpful to you for understanding the Shoshinge. So today I really wanted to talk about how to listen to Buddhism, how to learn Buddhism before I talk about the Shoshinge. Okay. So then the next, I will start talking about Shoshinge. So what is the Shoshinge? The Shoshinge was created by Shinran Shonin, the founder of the Jodo Shin Buddhism. However, it is not an independent work, but a hymn that appears at the end of a chapter on practice of the Kyogyo Shinsho. Kyogyo Shinsho is the main work of Shinran Shonin. In English, it is the title is The True Teaching, Practice, and Realization of the Pure Land Way. And if I go into details about Shinran Shonin's writings, I would also need to talk about his life. But today, I will briefly introduce Shinran Shonin's life. Shinran Shonin was born in Kyoto, Japan, 1173. Then he received his ordination from Master Jien and began monastic life on Mount Hiei. Yeah. He descends Mount Hiei and met Honen Shonin and entrusted himself to the Nembutsu teaching. Okay. I will just cover the highlights of Shinran Shonin's life. Okay. Then when he was 52 years old, he started writing Kyogyo Shinsho. He was exiled to to Echigo, the present Niigata prefecture. And after it was pardoned, after he was pardoned, he moved to Hitachi province, the present Ibaraki prefecture in the Kanto region. Then when he was in Kanto region, he started writing the Kyogyo Shinsho. Then when he was 63 years old, he returned to Kyoto. Then he wrote so many writings. Then especially after he returned to Kyoto, he put a lot of effort into writing and wrote many works during this period. By the way, do you know how many works Shinran Shonin wrote? Here is a chronological list of his works. It's not necessary to remember, but I just wanted to introduce his works. Actually, he wrote many writings. When he was 52 years old, he started writing Kyogyo Shinsho. Then there are many other works. He died in 90 at the age of 90, but he continued writing. The last one he wrote was the Hymns of the Dharma Ages, Shozo Matsuwa-san. Then he wrote it when he was 86 years old. So as you can see, there are so many writings of Shinran Shonin. Of course, we can still read these writings today. The content of these books is academic, so it may be a little hard to read them. However, some of them may be easy to read. But for example, Hymns of the Pure Land, Hymns of the Pure Land Masters, and Hymns of the Dharma Ages are hymns consisting of four verses in which Shinran Shonin himself praises Amida Buddha in an easy to understand and simple manner. So these hymns may also be a good starting point for learning the teaching of Shinran Shonin. The Kyogyo Shinsho, which includes the Shoshinge, is the main scripture of Jodo Shin Buddhism. Then Shinran Shonin started to compose it at the age of 52 in... In 1224, and this year was designated as the year of the founding of Jodo Shin Buddhism. As some of you know, in 2023, we will be celebrating the joint celebration for Shinran Shonin's 850th birthday and 800th anniversary of the establishment of the Jodo Shinshu tradition. And this year of establishing the Jodo Shinshu tradition was when he began writing the Kyogyo Shinsho, which includes Shoshinge. This is general information of Shinran Shonin and his writings, his works. Then why do we chant the Shoshinge? So now I will talk about why we chant the Shoshinge. We can chant the Shoshinge, and it begins with the rhythmic chanting of Kimyo Muryo Junyo Rai. Since I have been talking a lot today, I want to show you a video. The Honganji Temple in Kyoto has a morning service every morning, and the Shoshinge is chanted. So I want to show it. I want to share it with you. Can you see the video? Honganji website. They start the service with the temple bell. Everybody can attend the service. They are chanting for singing. Every morning they do. I just wanted to show the scene of the Shoshinge chanting. And at the Hirobetsuin too, we chant the Shoshinge every morning from 8 o'clock a.m. except for Sundays. Today, before this session, I and Kamuro Sensei chanted the Shoshinge together. In Japan, there was a custom that Jodo Shinshu families chant the Shoshinge together in front of the family altar in the morning and the evening. However, I heard that this custom has declined due to changes in the social environment and family situations. But I have also heard that many people still start their day with the Shoshinge chanting. In Hawaii, you may listen to or chant the Shoshinge at funeral services other than the morning service. Of course, you know, we can chant it at any service, but you know, since we always chant at funerals, some people told me, oh, sensei, when I hear the Shoshinge, I always remember the funerals for my parents. 親鸞 聖人 composed the Shoshinge, but actually he never indicated that he intended for the Shoshinge to be chanted. Do you know the Renyo Shōnin? You know, in the Honganji temples, usually the right side, facing the altar, the right side is Shinran Shōnin. The left side, there is a scroll of Renyo Shōnin. He is the eighth head minister of Honganji in Kyoto, and he extracted the Shoshinge from the Kyōgyō Shinshō and established the format of chanting it together with the hymns or wasans. Actually, before the time of Renyo Shōnin, the sutra titled Rokuji Raisan, verses of praise six times a day, was used for chanting. However, it is said that this was chanted only at the mother temple, Honganji, and usually the people couldn't chant the sutras. However, through the effort of Renyo Shōnin, the Shoshinge was published and disseminated. Then everyone, not only just ministers, came to chant it. As a result, the Honganji member increased and the Honganji denomination expanded greatly. Actually, Renyo Shōnin did so many things, but he enabled all the, you know, the Nembutsu followers to chant the Shoshinge. So this is one of Renyo Shōnin's effort. He published the Shoshinge in 1473. So this tradition has continued for 548 years. So I mentioned that I and Kamuro sensei chanted the Shoshinge this morning, but about 548 years ago, you know, many people did the same thing. I think this is amazing. And thanks to Renyo Shōnin, we can chant the sutra today. The Shoshinge is longer than other sutras, such as Sanbutsuge, Jūsēge, so some people may prefer the other sutras or shorter sutras. What do you think? But however, I hope you will keep remembering how revolutionary it was for everyone to chant the sutra and how great it is that this tradition has been handed down. And there are three main ways of chanting Shoshinge. In Japanese, it is called Sōfu, Gyōfu, and Shinpu. In addition, there are other chanting styles for funerals and special services. We can chant the sutras by ourselves, but it would be very moving when many people chant sutras together and their voices are in perfect harmony. It is said that by praising the virtue of Buddha together, other people will also come to have a connection with Buddhism. So you can find the Shoshinge in various books, including our service books. So I want to introduce some available books in Hawaii. Okay. So the Jodo Shinshu service book includes the Shoshinge. Now, this is the online version is available in Honpa Honganji Mission of Hawaii website. Then there is another Shoshinge service book. and the collected works of Shinran, which contains many Shinran Shonin's works. It includes the Kyogyo Shinsho, that means the Shoshinge is also included in this book. So I have talked about the general information of Shoshinge. So now I will talk about, actually, this is the main topic of my session. What is written in the Shoshinge? So first I will talk about the title of the book, Shoshinge. Actually, this is an abbreviation for the official title, Shoshin Nenbutsuge, which means the hymn of true and trusting in Nenbutsu. Shinran Shonin also used, but the Shinran Shonin used both words, you know, the Shoshinge, Shoshin Nenbutsuge, so we can use both. As I mentioned earlier, the Shoshinge is a part of Shinran Shonin's main work, Kyogyo Shinsho. Then just before the Shoshinge, there is a passage that Shinran Shonin stated why he composed the Shoshinge. I wanna share it with you. Shinran Shonin said, he said this just before Shoshinge starts. Here, then, wishing to realize the Buddha's benevolence and to respond in gratitude to the Buddha's virtue, I turn to Master Tanran's commentary, which states, the Bodhisattva takes refuge in the Buddha. Just as filial children obey their parents and the loyal retainers follow their rulers with their behavior, not self-centered, and their acts always according with reason. Since the Bodhisattva is aware of the Buddha's benevolence and respond in gratitude to the Buddha's virtue, he naturally addresses the Buddha first. So I will skip. Thus, taking refuge in the true words of the great sage and turning to the commentaries of the revered patriarchs, I realize the depths of and vastness of the Buddha's benevolence and compose the following hymn. So then this sentence is followed, and this passage is followed by the beginning of the Shoshinge. Then at the beginning of this passage, Shinran Shonin said, wishing to realize the Buddha's benevolence and to respond in gratitude to the Buddha's virtue. But in other words, that when Shinran Shonin encountered the teaching of Nenbutsu and learned it, he was profoundly impressed by Amida Buddha's great compassion and wanted to express his gratitude and praise for the virtue of Buddha. So through the Shoshinge, Shinran Shonin praised Amida Buddha and described what kind of Buddha Amida Buddha is. No? By the way, but this is the altar of Hirobetsuin. So in the center of the altar, there is a statue of Amida Buddha. You know, we always put our hands together, in front of the altar and say the Buddha's name, Namo Amida Butsu. So now let's read the text of the Shoshinge. I will read the text and its English translation and talk about the contents. So if you like, you can read it with me on your side. Kimyo muryo junyo lai namo fuka shigi ko. I take refuge in the Tathagata of immeasurable life. I entrust myself to the Buddha of inconceivable light. So I wanna take time to read, you know, each. I wanna, you know, take time to read each part, but today I would like to give a brief explanation to cover the content as much as possible. These first two phrases are Shinran Shonin's declaration of his own entrusting to Amida Buddha. Actually, these two phrases are paraphrases of Namo Amida Butsu. The name Amida Buddha has the meaning of immeasurable life and inconceivable light. So these words have various meanings, but immeasurable life means infinite in time, and inconceivable light means infinite in space. Therefore, Shinran Shonin expressed that he entrusts his heart to Amida Buddha, who is always with him, anytime, anywhere. Of course, you know, needless to say, Amida Buddha is always with each of us, you know, anytime and anywhere. The whole Shoshinge can be divided into two parts, although there may be different ways of dividing. Then the first part is a section based on the Pure Land Sutras. In Japanese, it's called Ekyodan. And there are Shinran Shonin expressed his own entrusting to Amida Buddha. Then Shinran Shonin wrote about Amida Buddha and Shakyamuni Buddha. Then in the second sections, he wrote about the teachings of the seven Pure Land Masters. Okay. So first two verses are the expression of Shinran Shonin's own entrusting. So we'll continue reading the Ekyodan, which is about Amida Buddha and Shakyamuni Buddha. Okay, so let's move on. Hozo Bosatsu Inniji Zaise Jizai Obusho Token Shobutsu Jodo In Kokudo Ninden Shizen Mak Konryu Mujo Shushogan Chouhotsu Keiu Daiguzei Goko Shiyui Shishouju Jusei Myosho Monjippo Bodhisattva Dharmakara in his causal stage under the guidance of Lokesvararaja Buddha searched into the origin of the Buddha's pure lands and the qualities of those lands and their main endeavors. He then established the supreme inconceivable vow. He made a great vow, rare and all-encompassing. In five kalpas of profound thoughts, he embraced this vow, then resolved again that his name be heard throughout the 10 quarters. So Shinran Shonin expressed his own entrusting heart at the beginning. Then from here, he explains what kind of Buddha Amida Buddha is. Actually, I wanted to talk about how to learn Buddhism at the beginning because of these passages. In the Shoshinge, Amida Buddha, Bodhisattva Dharmakara, and Lokesvararaja Buddha appeared in the story. When I talk about this story, I often receive the following questions. Sensei, is this a real story or a myth? Well, I understand Shakyamuni Buddha appeared in this world, but who Amida Buddha, Lokesvararaja Buddha, Dharmakara Bodhisattva is? Are they historical persons? If you have such questions, I want you to remember the diagram I showed earlier. Okay. So this diagram, the Shakyamuni Buddha appeared in the world of human beings, so this world. So it may be easy for us to understand who he is. However, Amida Buddha, Bodhisattva Dharmakara, and Lokesvararaja Buddha can only be understood in the world of enlightenment. Then Shakyamuni Buddha introduced Amida Buddha who was deeply respected and praised by many Buddhas. Amida Buddha is Amida Buddha is the Buddha of infinite light and life without color or form. But Shakyamuni Buddha used the narrative and personified Amida Buddha in order to make the characteristics easy to understand. Therefore, the story about Amida Buddha is neither a true story nor a myth, but a story about the truth. Then let's go into the content. Amida Buddha was first the Bodhisattva Dharmakara before he became a Buddha. When he was still in the stage of Bodhisattva, he witnessed the suffering of all beings in various worlds under the guidance of his teacher, Lokesvara Raja Buddha. Then after that, he established 48 vows because he sincerely wanted to save all beings, regardless of whether they are good or bad. Then he also promised that his name, Namo Amida Butsu, would be heard all over the world. Then, in order to establish these vows, he took a very long time, 5 kalpas. I would like to talk about the 5 kalpas a little more. We hardly hear about this unit of time, but kalpa is a unit of time. To explain this length of kalpa, the following explanation is often used. Let's say there is a huge rock that is 100 miles tall, 100 miles wide, and 100 miles long. Then every 3 years, a heavenly maiden descends from the heaven on the rock, give it a quick stroke with the sleeve of her robe, and then returns to the heavens. Then one kalpa is the length of time it takes for her to wear the rock down to nothing. Then 5 kalpas is 5 times 1 kalpas. So actually, the 5 kalpas is a tremendously long time that I cannot even imagine. And this is a really big rock. Yeah. So since we never see such a big rock, I try to think of something familiar. This is Mauna Loa on the Big Island. Mauna Loa is the largest mountain on Earth with an estimated volume of 18,000 cubic miles. And this is not highest mountain, but this is the largest mountain. The huge rock in the story is about the size of 55 Mauna Loa. Okay? Please imagine the heavenly maiden descends from the heaven once in 3 times and give only 1 stroke and return to the heaven. Then she repeats that until she wears the rock down to nothing. Actually, it takes so long time. And why did Bodhisattva Dharmakara spend so long to establish the vows? It was because he really wanted to find a way to save all of us who encounter various suffering in this world. In order to figure out how to do that, he had to think for a long time. The Shinran Shonin declared, When I ponder that the compassionate vow of Amida Buddha established through five kalpas of profound thought was made for me, Shinran alone, because I am burdened so heavily with karma, I feel even more deeply grateful to the primal vow which was made precisely to save me. Shinran Shonin's acceptance was, it was for me, Shinran alone. There is a Japanese word, anata yori, anata wo omou kata ga iru. Actually, this word was said by a Honganji member in Japan. In English, it means, there is someone who thinks about you more than you do. How would you feel if there is someone who cares about you, worries about you, wants to remove your suffering, wants you to be well, wants to protect you, wants to make you happy, and always feels the same way about you? So let's say, you know, you receive the surprise gift from your family or friend, then how would you feel if that person tells you that he or she had spent a month thinking about what the best gift is and chose something that you really like? Do you feel happy? I'm sure you would feel happy. Then Bodhisattva Dharmakara spent not one day, not one week, not one month, no, but five kalpas to think about each one of us. This is a truly amazing part. So could you try to add your name to this sentence? We always hear that Amida Buddha has great compassion, then I think the explanation about the five kalpas would give us some idea of how deep and how great Amida Buddha's compassion is. So if I, actually this is the Shinran Shonin's words, but if I read this, when I ponder that the compassionate vow of the Buddha established through the five kalpas of profound thought was made for me, Kazunori Takahashi alone. Yeah, so I should read this passage in this way. Okay, so I wanna talk about this passage a little bit more. Oh, anyway, but time is limited. Yeah, you know, when you attend the Honganji funeral service, we chant the Shoshinge, and from the middle of the Shoshinge, we start offering of incense. Do you know that timing? At that time, minister, you know, we chant the Shoshinge, and at that time, we chant Goko Shinyui Shishouju. That means, you know, Amida Buddha spent five kalpas to establish the vow. Then we chanted that part in different tone, because it is said that because that part is really important. Yeah, this is that part is really important. Okay. So I will move to the next part. Fuho muryo muhenko muge mutai koen no shoujo kangi chieko fudan nanji mushouko chonichi gakko shoujin setsu issai gunjo mukosho. Everywhere he casts light immeasurable, boundless, unhindered, unequaled light, lord of all brilliance, pure light, joyful light, the light of wisdom, light constant, inconceivable, light beyond speaking, light excelling, sun and moon, he sends forth illuminating countless worlds, the multitudes of beings all receive the radiance. Okay. After five kalpas of contemplation, the Bodhisattva Dharmakara practiced for even longer time, perfecting the pure land and becoming Amida Buddha. Then it is said that Amida Buddha emits 12 rays of light to illuminate all sentient beings widely. And these lights are important in knowing what kind of Buddha Amida Buddha is. I just listed the 12 lights as follows. So this is the last passage that I want to talk about today. Hongan myogo shoujo go shishin shingyo gan ni in joto gakusho dai nehan hishi metsudo gan joju. The name embodying the primal vow is the act of true settlement. The vow of entrusting with a sincere mind is the cause of birth. We realize the equal of enlightenment and supreme nirvana through the fulfillment of the vow of attaining nirvana without fail. This part is a little bit academic, but Shinran Shonin stated that we'll be born in the Pure Land because of the name or Namo Amida Butsu, which embodies Amida Buddha's primal vow, which is the 18th vow of the 48 vows. In addition, we can attain enlightenment because of Amida Buddha's 11th vow. Actually, it's very difficult for us to be born into the Pure Land and become a Buddha by our own effort, but it is possible thanks to Amida Buddha's working. However, we cannot become a Buddha now because we have blind passions tied to our body. Therefore, when our life ends, we will be able to become a Buddha. Then in Jodo Shin Buddhism, it is very important for us to listen to Amida Buddha's vows and have no doubt. Have you ever heard the Japanese word Shinjin, which means entrusting heart? Shinran Shonin said, Shinjin is hearing the vow of the Tathagata and being free of doubt. He also said, entrusting ourselves to inconceivable Buddha wisdom is taught to be the cause of birth in the fulfilled land. I mentioned the purpose of Buddhism is to attain Buddhahood or to attain perfect peace. So some people might think that in Jodo Shinshu, we can achieve the goal after this, not during our lifetime. Is this the teaching for life after this life, not for now? And I wanna introduce one more teaching. This is also one of the characteristics of Jodo Shinshu teaching, but Shinran Shonin said that in this life, we are determined to become a Buddha and will attain the stage of the truly settled and will never return. In Japanese, this stage is called Shoujoju. Shinran Shonin said that this is a great merit and virtue. About this teaching, the former Gomonshu, Koshin Otani said, it is not just a matter of receiving a ticket to the Pure Land and feeling relieved, but a matter of receiving Amida Buddha's light here and now. Then we can realize that we have been living our lives relying on our blind passions. But at the same time, we can also realize that Amida Buddha's wisdom and compassion should be the foundation of our life. No? So the conclusion, The time is limited today, so I must, you know, end here. After this part, the Shinran Shonin wrote about Shakyamuni Buddha and the seven masters who transmitted the Pure Land Buddhism in India, China, and Japan. Then throughout the Shoshinge, Shinran Shonin praised the virtue of Amida Buddha. Then by reading this text, we can better understand who Amida Buddha is, what Amida Buddha is doing for us, and the essence of the teaching of Jodo Shinshu, or Shinran Shonin's teaching. And lastly, I would like to share one episode related to the Shoshinge. I met an elderly Honganji member at some temple in Hawaii. She always attended the temple services. Then I often talked with her about Buddhism, and she sometimes asked me a question about Buddhism. Then one day, she asked me a question about the beginning part of Shoshinge. The question was, Sensei, I understand the meaning of Kimyo Muryo Junyo Rai, Namo Fukashigi Ko. I also learned about Hozo Bosatsu, but what is Inniji? She asked me this question, what is Inniji? Then I said, Inniji means the time Dharmakara Bodhisattva was still in the stage before becoming a Buddha. He wanted to save all of us. Then after that, she said, oh, Sensei, thank you very much. That's wonderful. I should just entrust my heart and say Namo Amida Butsu, right? She said. Then I said, yes, that's right. Then I said the Nenbutsu with her. However, after a while, she asked me the same question again. Sensei, you taught me about Inniji, but I forgot what it was. Could you tell it to me again? Then I gave her the same explanation. Then she said again, oh, Sensei, that's wonderful. I just entrust my heart to Amida Buddha and say Namo Amida Butsu, correct? Then I said, yes, that's correct. Then I said, Nammandabu, Nammandabu with her. Then, you know, after a while again, she asked me, oh, by the way, Sensei, what is Inniji? I had the same conversation several times, but this was a really precious experience for me because, you know, I could talk about Shoshinge. Then I really enjoyed learning about, you know, Shoshinge, Amida Buddha together. Now, of course, it's great to learn more about the content of the Shoshinge. It will help us to appreciate the Amida Buddha's working more. However, even if we cannot remember the content, we can remember the depths of Amida Buddha's compassion from any part of the Shoshinge anytime. So I humbly hope that all of us, together with the ministers, temple members, family members, and the Dharma friends, will continue to learn more about the Shoshinge. You know, we can learn together from one question like, oh, what is Kimyo Muryo Junyo Rai? Who is Amida Buddha? Who is Hozo Bosatsu? Then from this question, you know, we can together learn Jodo Shinshu teaching. And if today's lecture can help with that, I am truly pleased. So thank you very much. And Namo Amida Butsu. Namo Amida Butsu.
Thank you, Rinman Takahashi, for your presentation. Now we'll be moving on to the live Q&A portion of the program. Rinman Takahashi will be calling on those who have questions, and please unmute yourself before speaking.
Okay, so do you have any questions? Yeah, today I talked about many different things, not only Shoshinge, but also the general information of Jodo Shinshu, Shinran Shonin, also how to listen to Buddhism. Yeah, any kind of questions, I appreciate. Not only questions, if you have any comments, I appreciate if you can share. Okay. Oh. Thank you very much. I received the comments. Ah, okay. And Mr. Ito, can you hear my voice? Ah, okay. Mr. Ito, thank you very much for your comment. I appreciate your comments. Okay. What else is in the Shoshinge? Yeah. So, today, I covered only the beginning part of the Shoshinge. Yeah, so because time is limited, I cannot cover the rest of Shoshinge. But after that, Shinran Shonin talked about, you know, Shakyamuni Buddha. You know, Shakyamuni Buddha was a historical Buddha who appeared in this world. Then Shinran Shonin talked about how Amida Buddha and Shakyamuni Buddha related. Then after that, Shinran Shonin talked about seven pure land masters, you know, who transmitted the Nembu's teaching in India, China, and Japan. Then Shinran Shonin talked about the essential part of the pure land teachings. I hope this is I could answer your question. Okay. Oh, Mr. Ito, was it okay? Anyway, that's selectively or in the future. Ah, yes, yeah, yeah. I'm thinking, yeah, I wanna talk about, you know, the rest of Shoshinge when I have a chance. Okay. Okay. Share the 12 Amida Buddha's light. Okay, I will. Okay, thank you very much for your question, the TJ. Okay, so Shinran Shonin talked about the characteristics of Amida Buddha. Actually, Amida Buddha is the Buddha of immeasurable light and life, and we receive Amida Buddha's light. And it is said that this light has 12 features. Then, I cannot talk about the details of the 12 lights, but through, you know, learning the 12 lights, you know, we can know what kind of Buddha Amida Buddha is. Yeah. Okay, one moment, please. Yeah, so this is These are the 12 features of, you know, Amida Buddha's lights. Yeah. Okay. I wonder if I could answer your question. Okay, thank you very much, Janie Karimoto-san. Yeah. How is the Wasan related to the Shoshingen? Okay, thank you very much for your question. Okay, so as I briefly explained, the Shinran Shonin wrote many works. Then the Wasans are part of Shinran Shonin's writing. One moment, please. Even in this service book, there are some wasans. Like this. I wonder if I can share this. So this is, you know, one wasan. Sorry, but this page does not have English translation. Then, if I talk about the relationship between Shoshingen and Wasan, you know, I can say that, you know, in Honganji temples, you know, as I mentioned, we chant Shoshingen. After that, we chant six Wasans. Then, actually, there are so many Wasans. Then every day, we select the different six Wasans. So then this chanting style was created by the Renyo Shonin. If I talk about the relationship between Shoshingen and Wasan, I think that's the relationship. Okay. Oh, thank you very much. Okay, this is a comment from TJ. So the Janie, I hope I could answer your question.
So the wasans, because I don't understand Japanese.
Yeah.
And I don't know how to read, and therefore, you know, I chanted Shoshinge with Reverend with Reverend Umitani every day.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
With Reverend Umitani every day. And every day we took in five or six wasans.
Yes,
and
six wasans, yeah.
Yeah, so I never knew, I mean, I never understood Shoshinge to begin with.
Yeah.
And then, so the wasans are Shinran's thoughts?
Yes, actually Shinran Shonin composed. Yeah. Wasans. Then each wasan has the, you know,
the teaching.
Yeah, Shinran Shonin summarized, you know, various teachings of the Pure Land Buddhism. The wasan, one wasan is very short, but therefore there are so many wasans.
Right.
Yeah.
So each wasan is like a lesson.
Yeah. Yes, from each wasan, we can learn, you know, something. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes. Okay, but thank you very much for your question. Okay, so, now 11:22. Oh, Kamuro-sensei, thank you very much for your question. What is your most favorite words from Shoshinge and why? Okay, just now I thought of the word Goko Shiyui Shishouju. Yeah. I think this is wonderful, you know, Amida Buddha spent 5 kalpas for me, you know. He thought, you know, he spent so long time to save me and prepare the Namo Amida Butsu. So I think this is a really great part. Well, maybe I talked about this part today, so I thought of, you know, this word, you know, immediately. But I think that's a really great, my favorite part. But Kamuro-sensei, thank you for asking. By the way, Kamuro-sensei, so how about sensei? Which part, which word do you like? Is it okay to ask?
Thank you, Takashi-sensei.
Hi.
My favorite words from Shoshinge is Daihi Muken Joshouga.
Oh.
Which is nevertheless great compassion is untiring and illumines me always.
Oh. Kamuro sensei.
Genshin, Master. Yes. Yeah, Genshin's words.
Kamuro sensei. Yeah, thank you very much for your answer. Maybe we should talk about this you know, later. Anyway, you know, Kamuro-sensei mentioned the Daihi Muken Joshouga. This word appears in the, the ending part, the latter half of the Shoshinge. Yeah, then, but today I didn't cover it, but you know, after hearing Kamuro-sensei's comment, I hope, you know, I hope there is a chance to talk about that part, you know, at some occasion in the future. Okay. So, okay, apparent current actually teacher that I really think that. Mr. Ito, thank you very much for your comment. Yeah, yes, of course. And Mr. Higa, how is Shakyamuni Buddha related to Amida Buddha? Okay, let me briefly, you know, explain, answer this question. Shakyamuni Buddha appeared in this world and talked about so many teachings, yeah, including the Pure Land Buddhism. Then Shakyamuni Buddha, as I mentioned, introduced Amida Buddha. Then he talked about so many teachings, but Shinran Shonin said, Shakyamuni Buddha was born in this world to talk about Amida Buddha. You know, we cannot perceive Amida Buddha's wisdom and compassion because it's beyond our perceptions. But thanks to Shakyamuni Buddha, we can know that, you know, Amida Buddha is working for us. So this is the relationship between Amida Buddha and Shakyamuni Buddha. Okay. And okay, so now 11:25, I really appreciate, you know, your questions. But now 11:25, so we must finish today's session.
Thank you everyone for your time today. I hope this class helped you to understand the Shoshinge. We'll send out a questionnaire about this class at a later date. Please fill it out as it will help us improve our classes. Next month's class will be on Saturday, December 11th. From 10 to 11:30, the speaker will be Reverend Tatsuo Muneto, and the topic will be Living with Wisdom and Resilience, Following the Footsteps of Nembutsu Practitioner on the Big Island. Please subscribe to our new YouTube channel, Hawaii District Ministers Association. Also, your donations will be greatly appreciated. You can find this online donation link in the chat or on the screen. If you wish to write a check, please make the check payable to Hawaii District Honganji Consul, with HDMA seminar on the memo and mail it to PO Box 6027 Hilo, Hawaii 96720, attention treasurer. Thank you again for your time today. Please stay safe and healthy. Thank you.
Okay, excuse me. So to close today's session, so if you are able to, you know, please put your hands together in gassho and shall we say the nembutsu together? Namo Amida Butsu. 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 Okay. Thank you very much.